Stand with me just for a moment. I want to share with something with you since it's family and friends moment. Since it's family and friends day, there's something the Lord wanted me to speak to you about your our family, and I'm just going to shorten it. Give me 15 minutes, okay? Turn to John the 13th chapter really quickly. John the 13th chapter. Word of God says that you have many fathers, you have many teachers, but you have not many fathers. Today I want to be a father. Just for the next 15 minutes, I want to take advantage of this moment. John 13, verse 1. It was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave the world and to go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Jesus, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he listened to this. He got up from the meal. He took off his outer clothes. He wrapped a towel around his waist. And after that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his feet, his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. And after that, he came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" And Jesus replied, "You don't realize now what I'm doing, but later you'll understand." "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Listen to this, y'all. Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." Last verse. "Then, Lord," Simon Peter replied, "not just my feet, but wash my hands and my head. Just give me a Calgon bath." Amen. Next, last verse. Jesus answered, "Those who have a bath need only to wash their feet. Their whole body is clean, and you are clean, though not every one of you." 15 minutes. I just want to give you some bullets to write down. I'll preach next week, okay? But these are some principles that the Lord wanted me to share with you concerning our family, because I'm concerned about the family. Father, we thank you and we bless you for this day. I honor you for the next 20, 15 minutes that we have together. I pray, Lord, that you would use this moment to help us to understand the importance that you have in regards to service and family. We believe it to be done. It is so, and so it is in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I literally only need 15 to 20 minutes with you. For those of you that came, are visiting with us, we're very grateful for you. But if you want to hear me preach, come back next week or just buy the CD. It sounds better on the CD anyway. I really believe that Small Fire was supposed to be the person that the Lord wanted to use today to produce healing in our lives. Aren't you grateful for her? Amen. Thank God for her. There's a verse that each and every one of us need to have, and I need you to hear this. Each and every one of you need to have a verse that characterizes your life. So my challenge for all of you as homework assignment, for those of you that are governed by this ministry and even those of you that are visiting, I think it's just good wisdom. For those of us that are Christians, those of us that are connected to the body of Christ and believe that the Word of God is the primary source of authority in our lives, you need to find at least one verse that illustrates, that articulates why you live. Why you live. And so I'm challenging you to do that. When you get home, I want you to begin to think about, what is the purpose for my life? Why do I live? Why do I get up every single day? And what do I want to make manifest before I die? And then I want you to find the scripture that characterizes that. Jesus operated in this earth in a multiplicity of different things, but I believe that there's only one verse that his life really characterized, and it was this. I believe that the verse that characterizes Jesus' life is this. Well done, thy good and faithful servant. Well done, thy good and faithful servant. I had a pastor challenge me on last week. It was a great challenge. Sometimes you need people in your life to challenge you on why you do what you do. And I was sharing with him about my Israel trip, and then I shared with him about another trip that I'm about to take. And he says, Daryl, I got to ask you a question. He says, man, you never stop moving. You're always gone doing some type of ministry, always building something. You're always serving in some capacity. He says, why do you do what you do? And I couldn't answer that question initially, immediately. I said, I need to pray about that. And I began to pray about that, and I ran across a passage in Matthew, the 20th chapter, that says, well done, thy good and faithful servant. And when I ran across that particular passage, I knew that that's exactly why I do what I do. Because I don't want to be known as some great man that did signs and wonders and miracles and exploits, that built a wonderful church, that was able to do great things in the city of Knoxville and abroad. I want my two-minute remarks to be when I die. He was a servant. I guess that's a question that I need to ask you really quickly. What is it that you want people not to say about you while you are living, but what do you want people to say about you when you die? I preach enough funerals to sit down and listen to people at home going services and hear person after person after person stand up and lie about the person that's in the coffin. I don't even know why y'all acting like that, because you go to those funerals. The person was as mean as a snake, just terrible, never loved anybody, never cared about anybody, was a taker, not a giver. And then the people get up, and because out of obligation, they think that they're supposed to make that person be somebody that they were not. They get up in the two-minute remarks and lie in church about how wonderful that person is. Put people that more than likely are in hell in heaven. You know why? Because people don't live for their death. They live for their life. And I have determined in my life that I want to be a person that lives a life in such a way that people will be honest at my homegoing service and say, he was a servant. Not a great preacher, not a great homiletical expression, not a person that was hermeneutically sound, not a person that grew a great church. I want people to be able to stand up with all integrity in the two-minute remarks and say, you know what? He did a lot of things, but one of the things that characterizes his life is he served people. And so Jesus, all of the miracles that he did, the signs, the wonders, the exploits, when he feeds the 5,000, he was not just trying to prove that he could feed a lot of people. He was trying to show in that particular thing that he was a servant for people that were hungry. The first miracle that he worked in John, the second chapter, when he went to the wedding of Canaan and the wine ran out, he was not trying to show that he could take water and turn it into whatever alcohol you guys enjoy. He was trying to tell them that I'm a servant. I serve people when they're at the place of deficits in their lives. Even as he was healing the sick and raising the dead, he was not trying to prove that he was this great physician. He was really trying to teach the people of God that when other people are hurting and you've got God inside of you, you should hurt too. What will people say in your two-minute remarks? And so the last thing that Jesus does in John, the 13th chapter, as he's coming to the culmination and the climax of his ministry, the last thing he does is not parts the Red Sea. It is not that he pours down fire from heaven. It is not that he feeds 5,000 more people. It is not that he resurrects anybody. The last miracle that Jesus does before he dies, guess what it was? God. He was a very God, the very God. And instead of us serving God and being at God's feet, God gets down at the feet of sinful man. That's a miracle, sir. That's a miracle, man, ma'am, to serve people who ought not be served. Oh, you really wish that I would stop, but you know where I'm going with this story. You know where I'm going with this story, because he did not just serve certain people in this story. Y'all know where I'm going with this story. You see, he did not just serve Bartholomew or Matthew or Levi or Peter. You know what? He took off his clothes and he put on the garment of a servant, and he not just washed the feet of those who loved him. But after he got finished washing the feet of John, and after he got finished washing the feet of Matthew, and after he got finished washing the feet of Andrew, and after he got finished washing the feet of Philip, he went over to a man by the name of Judas. Knowing, theologically knowing, that he was about to be betrayed by the very same person that he was washing the feet. He did not dismiss Judas from the room and then start washing feet. No. He got down knowing that the moment he got finished washing this devil's feet, the devil was going to destroy him. It's easy for you to wash the feet of those that will wash yours, but can you wash the feet of your enemies? Do you want that to be said about you in your two-minute remarks? Jesus teaches us three quick things, and I want you to get it. The first thing, and most people miss this theologically because most of us read our Bibles way too quick, but the first thing that the Bible says is that Jesus told his disciples, I will meet you in the upper room. Y'all listen closely to me. He's first talking about their setting, the environment. Jesus met them in the upper room. I was just there last week in the very same room that he did this. He says, I want you to go into Jerusalem. It's at the Feast of the Passover, and I want you to meet me in the upper room. Everybody stay in the upper room. You see, miracles always take place in high places. Miracles always take place in high places. That's why you got to stop hanging with low people. If you keep hanging with low people, you'll never see high miracles. And Jesus says, I want you to go to the upper room, which is a high place, which is a high place. He begins to tell them that I'm instructing you to go to this high place that I've assigned you to be in. And the Bible says when he gets to this, they get to this high place, Jesus does some low ministry. You didn't hear what I just said. He sent them to a high place, but he was trying to teach them that as I take you to high places, it does not omit you from doing low service. I'm so sick and tired of people who will serve God. They love God. They'll run around the church. They'll sweep. They'll mop. They'll do whatever it takes until they get called to ministry. And then the moment they get called to ministry, the moment they get a collar around their neck and a cross that hangs around their neck, the moment they get a parking lot or a parking space, the moment they get a card with their name on it, the moment they get elevated in their business and start making a little money, they get out of the bucket and then buy your Benz, then they can't have nobody in their car no more. The devil is a liar. I said it earlier. I don't want anything that's going to take me so high that I can't continue to be low and serve God. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and God will lift you up. I don't know who I'm talking to today, but if you can't let nobody ride in your nice car, God know how to back that thing up and take away everything that he ever gave it to. Bump somebody and tell them, God the repo man. He knows how to back up everything that he gave you. You can go from a Bentley, a Benz, or a new Bugatti to riding at the bus all over again if you can't handle him taking you to high places. But you can't do low jobs anymore. You are not that wonderful. You are not that terrific that you got to pull people down to try to lift you up. He says, I came not to be served, but he says, I came to serve. The first shall be the last, and the last shall be first. He came into this room, listen to this, and the first thing he did, now I want you to mess this up theologically, the first thing that he did when he walked into the room, the Bible says it was after the supper. This is not the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper is about seven verses down after he washes the feet of the disciples. It is what we talk about, Holy Eucharist. It's the sacraments. It's a consecrated thing. We call it the Lord's Supper or communion. That's not what took place. It says after the supper. This supper was not something spiritual. It was a regular meal. The first thing that Jesus addresses is, how do we serve our family? How do we serve our family? You see, when we think about service, spiritual service, we automatically think about the church. But one of the things that the Lord has been working on me about is, how can you serve the church when you don't serve your family? Nobody's talking to me today. The Bible says, but how can you pastor the house of God when you can't even take care of your own family? The Bible says, I feel the Holy Ghost. The Bible says that a man that does not take care of his own family is worse than an infidel. He's worse than a person that ain't even saved. Even the dope dealer take care of his kids. So how can you be an armor bearer and open up the door for your pastor, but you don't even open it up for your own wife? You got it twisted, player. He's trying to teach us the importance of family. Trying to teach us the importance of serving your family. And then the Bible says after the meal, he starts doing spiritual stuff. 15 months into marriage, I ain't your pastor, but I'm just hearing the Holy Ghost. 15 months into marriage, don't make us laugh and make him frown. We've got to make sure that we understand the importance of it. You see, family was God's first fruit of ordination as it pertains to the kingdom of God. The church was not created till Acts. The church was not even created. It was not even birthed into the book of Acts till Jesus died. Jesus wasn't a member of a church. The church didn't start till Jesus died. This is much. This is too much. This is too much. This is too much. The church didn't start till Jesus died. God's first institution that he set up in the earth was not the church. It was family. Adam and Eve, he says, it ain't good for you to be alone. That was not Adam's choice. Adam didn't go to God talking about, it's another Valentine's Day gonna come up. I ain't with nobody. I'm tired of being by myself. Adam was so satisfied with God that he ain't want no woman. God must be satisfying. God must be satisfying when you so satisfied with God that you don't want nobody else. And I don't know who I'm talking to, but I need my single people to hear me today. You are not going to be good for nobody else if you ain't good for God. I don't know what I'm talking to today, but let me tell you something. My wife does not complete me. I was complete before I met that girl. But when I got to her, baby, she was a bonus to me. I'm satisfied with Jesus. Then God said, it ain't good for you to be alone. You know why God said it ain't good for you to be alone? He says, because I've ordained family to perpetuate the kingdom of God in the earth. I've ordained family to perpetuate the kingdom of God in the earth. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was out void, and the earth was dark, and darkness covered the face of the deep. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God separated the water from the firmament. He created the beast of the field, the fish of the sea, the fowl of the air, and every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. And God every day said, that's good. He created the trees and said to those trees, I'm going to make you to produce and perpetuate after your own kind. And then he creates Adam from the dust of the earth and breathes into Adam the breath of life, and man becomes a living soul. God says, that's good. Have you noticed that the devil ain't in existence right now? When God created the heavens and the earth, there was no devil in the garden. When God created the fish, the birds, and the beast, there was no devil
in the garden. When God created the trees, there were no devils in the garden. But when God said to Adam, it ain't good for you to be alone, and he pulls this woman out of the side of Adam, that's when the Bible says, and the serpent was more cunning than all of the other beasts. You see, the devil doesn't creep up into your garden until you start getting along with your family. So as long as you shacking up, oh, it got quiet just then. Long as you shacking up, long as y'all just live together and act married and do your own thing, y'all be fine. But the moment you say, till death do us part, I do, that's when the devil creeps up in your garden. Because the enemy hates family. Because family produces communities. Communities produces the church. And the church changes the world. Don't let nothing destroy or put a wedge between you and your family. Ain't nobody talking to me. I don't care how fine she is. She can be slim in the waist and pretty in the face. Y'all ain't talking. Why y'all looking at me like that? No. She can have the lips, the hips, and the fingertips. But girl, you fine, but you ain't gonna mess up what God trying to do in my family. Because at the end of the day, when you take your last breath, it ain't about your finances. All you have is your faith and your family. He said, I want you to serve your family. So he brings his guys together, and these guys are his family. So your family is not just the people who share the same DNA with you. It's who God has ordained to be in your life. First thing he does is he teaches them how to handle family. But then he doesn't just stop at washing the feet of Peter, James, and John. He now goes to Judas. Everybody say Judas. As a matter of fact, say amen 3 times. Amen. Reason I told you to do that, because you're not going to say amen what I'm about to say. Because it's easy for me to tell you to serve your Peters. But God has called you to serve and wash the feet of your Judases. He gets to Judas's feet, not knowing, not ignorant of the fact of what Judas was about to do. He knows exactly what Judas is about to do, but it does not stop him from washing his feet anyway. Because notice in the beginning of the passage, the Bible says after supper, Satan had put in the hearts of Judas to betray Jesus. He had put himself in Judas. Jesus never washed the foot of a devil. He washed the feet of a man who was dealing with some devils. Ooh, I'm trying to make your job better tomorrow. When you go to work tomorrow, baby, and you're kind to those people that try to dog you and destroy you, trying to get you fired, you ain't washing the feet of a devil. You're washing the feet of a person who Jesus loves, but has opened them up and have been exposed to a devil. And if the truth be told, you Judah today, praising God, but that was a time when you was Judas too. Ain't nobody talking to me. I'm through as I tell you this. The Bible says, do good to those who despitefully misuse you. He says, bless those that curse you. Did you hear what the text says? He says, bless people who curse you. He says, people who want you to die and will watch you starve and have the ability to help you. He says, when you see them starving, you feed them. You bake them a pie and don't put nothing in it. Y'all ain't talking to me. Y'all ain't talking to me. Because when you serve your enemies, whoa, Lord have mercy, God exalts you to high places. Let me say that one more time. My time is finished. When you serve your enemies, God will exalt you to high places. Say that as loud as you can. When I serve my enemies, God will exalt me to high places. Well, prove that. Let me prove it to you real quick as I close. The Bible says, listen to this, David. David, y'all know David. Y'all know David. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil. King David. The question is, how did David become a king? David became a king because he killed a giant that nobody else could kill. That's how he became a king. He became a king because he killed a giant that nobody else could kill. Now, the question is, was David out hunting for giants? No. Read your Bible. When Goliath was fighting against the Israelites, the Philistines had come against the Israelites and had them terrorized, David was not even on the battlefield. He wasn't even in the army. You know what he was doing? Taking care of sheep, cleaning up mess. He was cleaning up mess for his daddy. He wasn't even qualified to get in the war yet. His brothers, who hated him and was hating on him, was fighting. And David was in the field. His daddy Jesse looked at him and said, David, your boy, your brothers who hate you out there fighting for you, go take them some cheese. Go take him some bread. And David takes a little satchel and he gets some cheese and some bread, taking those that cheese and that bread to feed his brothers who hate him. And on the way, he heard somebody talking about his God. And the Bible ultimately says that David decided, you're not going to talk about my God. And he kills a giant. And when he kills the giant, God allowed Saul to put him in the kingdom. Can I tell you something? The reason David was able to kill giants and end up with kingdom authority is because he was serving people he didn't like. Y'all quiet now. Because you trying to kill some giants, and God told me, tell you, ain't killing not now one giant till you learn how to serve people that hate you, that despitefully misuse you. You will never be able to kill your giants or walk in your kingdom authority as long as you pick and choose who you gonna serve. He takes a towel, girds himself like a slave. The Savior puts on the attire of a slave. Divinity washes the feet of humanity. Does that not throw y'all off? Divinity washes the feet of humanity. A very God, the Word become flesh and dwell among men, gets down and washes the nasty feet of tax collectors. Why would he do that? Because he understands that sometimes I gotta love the hell out of people. Oh, that messed you up. Sometimes the only way you can get the hell out of people is to love the hell out of them. That's your boy. Sometimes the only way to pull the devil out of a person is to love them with as much Jesus that you have. This is how I'm closing. We talk about what Jesus put on, a towel, but what we don't think about is he had to take something off first. Jesus got naked in front of his family. Ooh, you better tattoo this right beneath your other tattoo on your chest. Jesus got naked in front of his family. You don't really never know whether you have a sincere relationship with anybody until you could willfully expose your nakedness and see what they do with it. Preach, man. See, a real friend is not a person you go to Applebee's with at the church. A real friend is not a person that is liked a picture on Facebook. A real friend is not a person that hangs up out with you during tax season. A real friend is not a person that can just shout with you at church. A real friend is a person that when you take all of your clothes off, you can show them your scars, your stretch marks. Y'all not talking to me. And they won't talk about you. They'll hold on to you anyway. Somebody said to me the other year, Pastor, as long as you write, you know I'm with you. I said, I don't need you in my life. I need somebody that'll be with me when I'm dead wrong. Holler at your boy today. Holler at your boy today. The Bible says a brother was born for adversity and a friend loveth at all times. He took it off. His rabbinic regalia, his messianic attire, he took it all off, including his tallith, including his prayer shawl. He took it off too. Mama, a Jewish boy don't take off his prayer shawl unless he's bathing. You keep it. I just left Israel. Every Jewish man has a prayer shawl on. I don't care if they're in a tailor-made suit. That tailor-made suit may cost $5,000, but you see their prayer shawl hanging up under it. You don't take that off. You know what Jesus was saying? Jesus was saying, just because I took off the stuff that represented my spirituality don't mean I ain't spiritual no more. Y'all ain't talking to me. Look at somebody and tell them I'm better than I look. Come on. Bump somebody else and tell them I'm better than I look, baby. I know I got Ferragamo on. I know I got Versace on. I know I got Louis on. I know I got Gucci on. But if I take all of this stuff out that's connected to somebody else's name, I can be butt naked, but I still got a name that is above every name. For at the name of... So I ain't got to have no titles. You ain't got to call me bishop or apostle, or you ain't got to call me pastor. I'll still lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. With a three-piece suit on or with some green flip-flops on, I'll lay hands on you and the devil has got to flee. My business card don't make me anointed. Touch somebody and tell them you have no idea who you sitting next to me. You have no idea. Touch somebody else. Tell them you have no idea who you sitting next to me. I'm through because y'all mad at me. My anointing, young people, your anointing is so much greater than your attire. You do not have to have $200 shoes to be popular. Y'all quiet. You ain't got to break your mama. And she shouldn't have to pawn her title so you can be cool with everybody else. And parents, y'all stop being stupid and buying it. You can't pay your rent, but they got the new Jordans. That's stupid. Shout it as loud as you can. Stop being stupid. How you gonna have a Benz parked in front of the projects? That's stupid. Big screen TV, fill your whole wall up because you want an efficiency. That's stupid. Gets to Peter. Peter said, not me. You're not washing my feet. The pendulum has swung the other way. Because Peter knows how to give grace. He just doesn't know how to receive it. Ugh.
And it's dangerous for you not to know how to receive.
See, you give away everything. You give away everything. Everything, you give it away. I just give it away. I just give it away. Seed time and harvest, I'm giving it away. Every time somebody gives, I'm giving that away. Let me tell you, if you keep giving and never receive, you ain't going to have nothing to give. As long as the earth remains, there will always be seed time and harvest. That's a principle. That's sure enough true. But the Bible says he gives seed to the sower and bread to the eater. Don't eat your seed, but don't sow your bread. That's much. That's much. Don't worry about it. That's much. You're not going to get that to the 4th of July. You're going to get that on the second rib. All I'm saying is you got to learn how to receive. Jesus said, oh, okay, I got it. So you that arrogant. So you know how to give, but you don't know how to receive. So what you're saying is you better than me. Okay. You can't have no part of me. Peter's like, I'll just plan. He said, give me a whole bath. And Jesus said, no, you need not a bath. He says, you're already clean. Now, what are you talking about? You just said I need to wash. He says, I don't need to wash your body. I just need to wash your feet. What he's saying is, spiritually, you're already clean. Forever. But if the truth be told, you can be saved, but your feet sure enough keep getting dirty. Don't let the person sitting next to you think that they just keep clean feet. Tell somebody, take off your shoes. You've been somewhere you shouldn't have been. Can I get over? You got some toe jam up in there. You want to show me your hands that I can see. I want to see your feet where I can't see. Where have you been this week that you hope doesn't show up on that screen? He said, let me take care of them feet. Let me tell you why. Because he's finished. He's finished with teaching. His life is finished. And what he's saying is he's saying this. I got to wash your feet because I can't allow where you've been in your past to keep you from fulfilling the promises that I have for you in your future. I gotta wash your feet. Everybody stand. I'll preach next week. I'll preach next week. Okay, I got it, Pastor. Gotta have my feet washed. I got it. Gotta have my feet washed. I got it, man. So I'm trying to stop smoking hard as I can this week. No more weed this week. Touch somebody, tell them two puffs and pass. They know what I'm talking about. Now, if they know what that is, check their feet. I ain't going over there. I ain't going over there. You still have missed it. What he was trying to teach Peter by washing Peter's feet. Y'all just give me a second. What's a mass exodus? What he was trying to teach Peter by washing Peter's feet is you're not responsible for cleaning yourself up. You can't. You're just responsible for getting in my presence like we did today and let me wash you. A couple of years ago, I'm terrible at washing cars, I ain't gonna lie. The Lord blesses us with nice automobiles and I just don't wash them. And so I decided, I got it. Down the street from my house, there was a car wash that you could buy a pass and wash, just ride through. You wash all you want. Unlimited. Just go. I said, oh, that's the Lord. That is the Lord. Keep first lady off of me. Keep lady on off. I'm good. All I got to do is pay in it. But you got to pay in advance. Seven of y'all believe what that stuff she was talking about. You really think that Free Willy was like, okay. So you've got to pay in advance. So lady could go get her car washed based upon me paying in advance for a debt that she didn't even have the ability to pay. So I paid, listen to this, for the wash of cars that wasn't even dirty yet. This is much. So even before the cars got dirty, the cleaning of the vehicles were already paid for. See, this way, okay, this much because y'all ain't getting it. God chose you in him before the foundations of the earth. He paid for your sin before you was born. You hadn't even got dirty yet. And so you got a prepaid salvation deal. When you pull up, they give you no bucket. They give you no rag. They give you no soap. You pull your vehicle up, and they point at a sign. And the sign has rules on it.
Yes.
This is good. The first rule is put your car in neutral. The second rule is take your feet off the brake. The third rule is take your hands off the steering wheel. Well, what do? I just got to line up. And the machine does the rest. Can I preach to about 200 of you and tell you, you ain't got to clean your life up. All you got to do is line up with the word and the will of God. Put your life in neutral. Take your feet off the brake. Lift up your hands and worship. And you're going to be better on the other side than you were when you went in. I need you to open up your mouth and give God the best praise you got, because he's lined you up. But you gotta serve your way through this. Serve your family. Serve your foes. Serve yourself. And serve the Savior. And everything else will turn around for you. Lift your hands. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for the family that is garnered and gathered around the cross today. Thank you, Lord, for this woman of God that led us in the supernatural healing through comedy. Thank you for the young people, oh God, the fruit of our loins, God, that have served you. Not in any type of form or fashion. You could look at them and tell they were worshiping you. Thank you, Lord. You created a Joshua generation to take us into the next place of God. And then thirdly, Lord, thank you for this word. That was short, but I sense precise, and I believe that it was a sword. I believe that it was a scalpel to cut off the tumors of sin that have been connected to us so that we might have life, and that life more abundantly. Take this word and sow it into our hearts that we might be able to produce a harvest in our family. The devil is a liar. He won't get my son. He won't get my daughter. Won't get my husband. Won't get my wife. Won't get my community. So while the devil is doing drive-bys on the west side, we're going to do drive-bys on the east side. We're going to spray the devil today with the word of God. We don't have a 45. We don't have a 9. We don't have a 40. Oh, but we got a 66. 66 books from Genesis to Revelation. Today we do a drive on the devil.
Hallelujah. And what the enemy means for evil, we make it work out for our good. Now grab somebody's hand all over this building. Every head is bowed, every eye is closed. We're over, but that's okay. Every head is bowed, every eye is closed. I don't care who you are. You could be a pastor, a bishop, an apostle. You could be a deacon. You could be an armor bearer. I don't care who you are. You need to assess who you are in your heart and where you are in the faith. And today I want you to find out where you are in God. Are you clean? Has the Lord covered you? Have you allowed him to wash your feet? So if you're in this place, you're not 100% sure that you're saved. You want to go to heaven. You don't want to go to hell. You want to live for Jesus. You don't want to live for yourself. Today is the day of salvation. Now is the appointed time. Second group of people, you say, hey, pastor, I'm saved. I'm going to heaven if I die, man, but I need a church. I need to be connected to a ministry, Lord, that's preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I want to be in a place where I understand the Bible. I've been going to church for years, and I go out of habit. I don't understand nothing the preacher's saying. I believe that this is the place where I'm supposed to be, and so I'm connecting today. Third group of people, you're saying, hey, pastor, look, I'm saved. I've got a church, but it's in Memphis. Stacy Spencer's my pastor. It's in California. Noel Jones is my pastor. It's in Chattanooga. Kevin Adams is my pastor. It's in Nashville. Bishop Walker is my pastor, but I'm here working, or I'm here in school, and I need to be connected through Watch Care. I just sense that this is the place where I need to be until I go back to my church. If you're in one of those three categories, when I count to three, I want you to squeeze somebody's hand as tight as you can, as though you were squeezing the bloodstained hands of Jesus Christ, saying, I want everything you got, God, if you're in one of those three categories. I'm not going to ask you to come up and sit down in the chairs and give a testimony. We don't have time for that. We're already way over time. We're 17 minutes over time. But today, I want you to give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ in a special way. Every head bowed, every eye is closed. You say, hey, man, I just came with my cousin. My cousin told me to come. I ain't come for all this, but God had your Holy Ghost had your address. I want you to respond. Don't you wait till Easter to give your life to Jesus. Easter may never come. One, don't let the enemy keep you down to know another day. If that's you, when I count to three, I want you to squeeze. Two, pride coming before destruction and a haughty heart before a great fall. Don't let the devil have one more second of your life. I'm talking to you. When I count to three, squeeze it. Three, squeeze that hand as tight as you can. We serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. Today. Father, I've done all I can do. No man can come lest he be drawn by you. If somebody squeezed your hand, I want you to lift that hand straight up in the air all over the building. I see your hands going up. They're going up everywhere. Keep them up. 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 Now, if somebody lifted your hand or you lifted their hands, I want you to bring them to me. I just want to hug them. Come quickly. Come quickly. Come quickly. Bring them to me. Bring them to me right now. Come on. Come on. Come on. Y'all ought to be praising God for the souls that's coming. Come on. Look at all of these young people. Look at these families. Look at these families. Come on. Y'all can do better than that. Come quicker. Come quicker.
Lifted me.
Hallelujah. Come on, come on, young people. Older people, men of God, women of God, come on. Bless you, man. Bless you, sir. Come on, they're coming from everywhere. They're coming from everywhere. Come on, people of God. Yes, sir. Y'all ain't praising God, you should be. Let them know that they're making the right decision. Bless you, man. Bless you. Bless you, bless you. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Bless you, man. It's good to see you. Bless you, bless you. Bless you, sir. Bless you, sir. Come on, lift your voices. Your love lifted me. Bless you, Lord. Baby. All right.
Lifted.
Let me expedite the time. Let me expedite the time. I ain't mad that we went over because the Lord did his thing. Hey, you got to go. This one of them days, you just let the collard greens burn, catch on fire, go get some more. Amen. Those of you that are at the altar, just lift your hand straight up. Those of you there, you got hundreds and hundreds of people that are praying for you right now. Those of you that are in the congregation, just stretch your hands towards my brothers and sisters. Let's do this real quick. Say, Father, in Jesus' name, Thank you for this day. I believe by faith that Jesus Christ died for my sin. Early the third day morning, he got up with all power in his hand. Say, I'm saved. I'm saved. I'm safe in Jesus' name. Put your hands together and thank God for the new believers that are in the kingdom and those that are connected to the ministry. They're handing you some cards now. Just want you to fill them out. Let's go home. Everybody.